All right, we're going to be talking about quasi-geostrophic theory now, and there are two fundamental equations that will lie effectively at the foundation of quasi-geostrophic theory. Starting with the quasi-geostrophic vorticity equation over here, the rate of change of the geostrophic vertical vorticity with respect to time at a point. So the local tendency in the vertical vorticity associated with the geostrophic wind can be expressed as an advection term over here minus ug dot del zeta g plus f. And this is going to be over here the advection, horizontal advection of the absolute vorticity plus a term over here that refers to the stretching of planetary vorticity, talking about the rate of change of vertical motion over here as we vary in the atmosphere with pressure over here. And again, when we talk about this, we're going to be using pressure as the vertical coordinate. That's what you see here in the denominator. Second equation that is going to be referred to a lot is the quasi-geostrophic thermodynamic energy equation, which I'm going to abbreviate as TDEE over here, saying that the rate of change with respect to time at a point of the thickness, partial phi, partial p, so we're talking about here, layers of the atmosphere bounded by pressure surfaces and the difference in G potential within those layers over here, getting to a thickness concept. It can be expressed as an advection over here of thickness. And remember, thickness related to the virtual temperature of that, mean virtual temperature of that layer of air from the hypsometric equation. And we're talking about the advection of that quantity over here, partial phi, partial p, plus a term over here that gadjusts that vertical motion and adiabatic temperature changes, that sigma omega, where sigma is referring to the static stability. And if you recall, let's just talk about geopotential real fast over here. Phi, this is a quantity called geopotential, and it can be related to the height field through the following expression, acceleration due to gravity g times the depth of the layer dz is equal to the change in geopotential through that layer of air. And as far as units are concerned, remember g is acceleration meters per second squared times meters. That gives us meters squared over second squared for our small chunk of geopotential change within that layer of the atmosphere. And this can be related to the temperature, mean virtual temperature of that layer of air. All right, let's come up with another useful relationship over here in terms of relationship between the geostrophic vertical vorticity and this quantity geopotential over here. Recall that the vertical vorticity of the geostrophic wind can be expressed as partial vg, partial x, minus partial ug, partial y. And we can use the relationship between the geostrophic wind over here and geopotential to plug that in as follows over here. So for vg, we're going to have partial x of 1 over f naught, partial phi, partial x, minus partial y, of minus 1 over f naught, partial phi, partial y. So just plugging in vg over here and ug over here. And you might wonder, you know, why does this work out sine-wise, S-I-G-N, sine-wise, where we have positive sign for vg, negative sign for ug? How do we memorize something like that? We already know that the change, the zonal change in geopotential is going to be related to a meridional wind geostrophically. And a meridional change in the geopotential is going to be related to a zonal wind for the geostrophic wind. Let's just kind of test this out so you guys kind of see a quick trick so you don't have to memorize the sign over here. Let's say we have a case with high geopotential over here. And then we have contours that go to the right over here with low geopotential. We know that in this particular case with high heights over here, low heights over here, the geostrophic wind is going to be pointing such that lower heights are to the left like this. So that we know is going to be the result. You know, lower heights, lower pressure, that's going to be to the left of the geostrophic wind. And so in this case where we're having the change zonally in the geopotential, we know we're going to have the 1 over f naught term, and we know we're going to get a meridional wind work out in this particular case. Let's check the sign. As we're going to the right over here, we're experiencing less geopotential. So this sign of this term over here will be negative. And well, we already know that we have a north to south wind, which refers to a negative meridional component of motion. And therefore, we don't have to put a negative sign over here. Alternatively, suppose we have a scenario where we have to the north low geopotential, and to the south, we have high geopotential over here. Geostrophic wind, we know, is going to go from the west to the east. And so we are going to have a geostrophic wind with the 1 over F naught that is going to be driven by a meridional change in the geopotential. Let's check the sign. If we're going to the north, geopotential is decreasing. And this is going to be negative, but we need to have a positive zonal wind. Therefore, we have to have a negative sign over here in order for us to actually have a geostrophic wind that points such that the lower heights, lower geopotential, lower pressure is to the left. So if you don't want to memorize which sign is which, you can always think conceptually about how the equations relate to what we actually see in the atmosphere. So let's proceed with this equation over here for the geostrophic vertical vorticity. We'll plug these in over here, and we get second partial derivatives. We have a 1 over F naught partial squared phi partial x squared plus 1 over F naught partial squared phi partial y squared. And we can effectively group together these terms such that 1 over F naught is brought out, factored out, and that leaves us with 1 over F naught times the Laplacian of the geopotential evaluated on a constant pressure surface over here. So del squared phi on using pressure, I should say pressure is the vertical coordinate, multiplied 1 over F naught is the geostrophic vertical vorticity. That makes things a little bit simple in terms of expression. The entire vertical vorticity fields spin in the atmosphere around a vertical axis can be related to the geopotential fields. So we have something that we're measuring from soundings, geopotential height, for instance. That field alone can tell us something about the way the geostrophic vertical vorticity would be within the atmosphere. So to sum up, zeta g is expressed as 1 over F naught del squared p of the geopotential over here. And if we were to take the time rate of change of the geostrophic vertical vorticity, we get partial zeta g partial t is equal to 1 over F naught times del squared p partial phi partial t. And this expression over here, the rate of change of geopotential with respect to time at a point, we're going to use that, we're going to use chi, the Greek variable chi here, to express that, effectively getting at the idea of a height tendency, geopotential height tendency, geopotential tendency. All of these are conceptually linked together. So partial phi partial t, we're going to write as chi over here. So partial zeta g partial t is equal to 1 over F naught del squared p of chi. So a height change, not directly, but conceptually, a height change over here is going to be related to the rate of change of geostrophic vertical vorticity with respect to time. So how the spin is changing in the atmosphere with time is going to be linked to a height change. All right, now we're going to get started with the quasi-geostrophic height tendency equation over here. And put a marker over here, QG chi equation. All right, we're going to start with the quasi-geostrophic vorticity equation that we have specified over here to the left. Partial zeta g partial t is equal to minus UG dot del zeta g plus F naught partial omega partial p. And we're going to replace with zeta g with the expression that we have over here using the equations that we had derived just now. So, and also partial zeta g partial t. We're going to get that expressed in terms of geopotential. So on the left-hand side of this equation, we'll have 1 over F naught del squared chi, and I'm going to be leaving out the subscript over here on the Laplacian, is equal to minus UG dot del 1 over F naught del squared phi plus F naught partial omega partial p. All right, now we're going to multiply both sides by F naught, bringing that to the right-hand side to get del squared chi is equal to minus F naught UG dot del 1 over F naught del squared phi plus F plus F naught squared partial omega partial p. Now we have a vertical motion term over here, but we're trying to get some expression that deals just with chi. So this term is going to need to be eliminated somehow. Well, we're going to use the quasi-geostrophic thermodynamic energy equation to allow us to do some manipulations to get that term to become eliminated. So let's now, I'm going to put a little break over here. Let's go to the quasi-geostrophic thermodynamic energy equation, partial T of minus partial phi partial P is equal to minus UG dot del minus partial phi partial P plus sigma omega. All right, and what we'll do over here is bring the negative sign out front, and we're going to switch the order of differentiation to get minus partial P of partial phi partial T is equal to, and we're going to have the minus signs multiply out to get positive UG dot del partial phi partial P plus sigma omega. All right, and what we're going to do now is have this expressed as chi, as we talked about earlier, minus partial P of chi is equal to UG dot del of partial phi partial P plus sigma omega. And what we're going to do right now is multiply both sides by minus 1. And at the same time, we're going to take F naught squared over sigma times partial P of both sides. So effectively, we're going to, and let's see. I'm going to, can everyone see over here, if I were to write over here? We're going to, any concerns? We're going to multiply both sides, so multiply both sides, by minus F naught squared over sigma, and then operating that on partial P of both sides to get the following, F naught squared over sigma partial squared chi partial P squared is equal to minus F naught squared over sigma partial P of UG dot del partial phi partial P minus F naught squared over sigma partial P of sigma omega. All right, well, at this point, once we had this operator go on what's above over here, we see that the sigmas can divide out over here, and we're going to be left with the following. I'm going to write this over here. F naught squared over sigma times partial squared chi partial P squared is equal to minus F naught squared over sigma partial P of UG dot del partial phi partial P minus F naught squared partial omega partial P. All right. Now what we're going to do together, we're going to do here is combine this equation over here with this equation over here. And what we see when we add these two equations together is that the way in which we had this operator act on the line above allows this term over here to cancel out with this term over here, effectively eliminating vertical motion between the two equations, isolating out this chi term. So we're going to add these equations together like this over here, and these two terms will cancel out to leave us with the following equation, del squared chi plus F naught squared over sigma partial squared chi partial P squared is equal to minus F naught UG dot del of 1 over F naught del squared phi plus F over here minus F naught squared over sigma partial P of UG dot del of partial phi, partial P. All right, now we're almost there in terms of an expression involving chi on the left-hand side. When we're dealing with these quantities in the atmosphere and in layers, and we're thinking about the layer in the atmosphere bounded by pressure levels, I should say, and we know that pressure is decreasing with height above the ground, so we can kind of think in general that a rate of change of height can be considered equivalent to minus partial p. So partial z can be thought of as a minus partial p. We want to get minus partial p's so that we're able to think of things as a finite difference of height within the layer of atmosphere. We're evaluating various forcing terms on the right-hand side of the equation. Well, when we do that, we're going to effectively put a minus sign here, balance that with a minus sign over here, and then we'll see how that works out. We'll del squared over here, and we're going to effectively take out the operator here on the left-hand side, so it's acting fully on chi, plus f naught squared over sigma partial squared partial p squared of chi, just effectively factoring out the operator acting on chi, which is going to be equal to, and let me separate this out over here, two terms minus f naught ug dot del of 1 over f naught del squared phi plus f minus f naught squared over sigma partial p of minus ug dot del of minus partial phi partial p. So we're doing that again in order to think about things as partial z, in other words, minus partial p. And so we put the minus sign here, balance it with the minus sign out here. All right, well, let's talk about what the quasi-geostrophic height tendency equation means. Yes, we just derived QG chi equation over here, and let's talk about some of the implications of the terms physically on the right-hand side of this equation. Well, over here, we have a minus UG dot del of this quantity, referring to the relative vorticity, vertical relative vorticity over here of the geostrophic wind plus F. So we're effectively talking about, when we combine that with planetary vorticity, absolute vorticity. This is the minus UG dot del of vertical vorticity, absolute vorticity. This is the advection of vorticity over here in on the right-hand side. So this is vorticity advection, VA over here. That's a forcing term. That results in responses to the height tendency. Here's a term over here. It looks pretty complicated, but really it's not. This minus partial phi partial p is just the change in g potential height throughout that column of air, which is related to the temperature, the virtual temperature of that column of air, mean virtual temperature. So we're talking about a minus UG dot del temperature is an advection of temperature. That's thermal advection. Well, a minus partial P, the way we had this work out through several manipulations over here, is like a partial Z, a rate of change of thermal advection with respect to height. That's a differential thermal advection. Well, we talked about the implications from the Lapsar tendency equation last time. Here it is again in the quasi-geostrophic height tendency equation. Differential thermal advection. How thermal advection varies with height within our column of air. And we see that on the left-hand side, we have a del squared plus a rate of change of some quantity with respect to pressure, second derivative for that. Well, this is just effectively a three-dimensional Laplacian operator using pressure as the vertical coordinate. Talking about a second derivative of chi. That's all it is on the left-hand side. Second derivative of chi can be expressed as vorticity advection and differential thermal advection. Well, what happens when we're talking about wave functions? We can approximate many processes in the atmosphere as waves. When we take a second derivative of a wave function like sine, say we have sine of theta, first derivative of sine of theta is cosine of theta, and then we take another derivative, we get back what we started out with, but with a minus sign. So the second derivative, sine of theta, is minus sine of theta. Second derivative of chi is like minus chi is effectively being forced by, the response over here is associated with forcing mechanisms of vorticity advection plus differential thermal advection. That's quasi-geostrophic high tendency equation. We took all of these basic underpinnings over here and come up with conceptually this very basic expression over here. And we're going to talk about how it manifests itself in the atmosphere once we derive the quasi-geostrophic omega equation.